In this video, we are going to find the value of this infinite sum. It was first found by Euler. For example, when you sum over 1 over k squared, you get pi squared divided by 6. When you sum terms to the 4th power, you get some multiple of the 4th power of p. We will also be able to evaluate some similar infinite sums using similar methods. So why does the series converge? When we look at the case where n is equal to 1, we can lower one of the terms in each fraction by 1. This bounds our sum from above. We can then rewrite the 1 in the numerator as a difference and split the fractions. Now the negative terms cancel out with some of the positive terms, and all that is left is 2. This tells us that our original series must be convergent. When we raise it to a higher power, the terms get smaller, so by the same argument, the series converges. The trick to evaluate the sum is to analyze the generating function. So we have a power series whose coefficients are the values we are looking for. By analyzing this function, we translate a problem from number theory to a problem of complex analysis. So let's look at the generating function. We can interchange the sum and pull this factor in. The inner function is known as the geometric series. This generally evaluates to 1 over 1 minus q. Since our sum starts at n equal to 1, we get this result. So our generating function takes this form. We can now perform some basic algebraic manipulations, and finally we obtain this form, where you can see that f has poles at every integer not equal to 0. So by dividing by the term in the front of the sum and adding a 1 over z, we get a function which has a pole at every integer of residue 1. An interesting property of this function is that when you plug in z plus 1, all the terms get shifted 1 to the right, but the value doesn't change. So this is periodic with period 1. When we look at the cotangent in this form, we see that it also has these two properties. And it turns out that these two functions are actually the same. We can show that this is true by noticing that the cotangent is a derivative of the sine divided by the sine. This is called a logarithmic derivative. When we have a positive function and we differentiate the logarithm of the function, we get by the chain rule that this is the logarithm divided by the original function. This motivates the definition of the logarithmic derivative. Using the product rule, we get that the logarithmic derivative turns products into sums. We are going to use that the same property also holds under certain conditions for infinite products of functions. Given the infinite product expansion of the sine, we can on both sides apply the logarithmic derivative. On the left side, we get the cotangent, and on the other side, an infinite sum. This is exactly the expression we already had for our generating function. So after some rearranging, we get that minus 1/2 plus the generating function is equal to a multiple of the cotangent. We can actually make sense of the minus 1/2. For that, we define the Riemann Zeta function. Our goal was to find the values at the even positive integers. By analytic continuation, we can assign a value to Zeta of 0. This is minus 1/2. Plugging this in, we get the generating function of the Zeta function at even integers is a multiple of the cotangent. So if we knew the Taylor series of z times the cotangent at the origin, we would have found the coefficients in our generating function. To find this, we can rewrite the cotangent like this. When we substitute and plug this back in, we get on the right side a very simple expression. We define the coefficients of the Taylor series at 0 to be the Bernoulli numbers. We can multiply on both sides of the equation by the denominator and plug in the Taylor series of the exponential function at zero to get this equation. We can now multiply the left side out and compare coefficients. We get that the zeros Bernoulli number must be 1 and that this sum must always be 0. By multiplying with n factorial, we can rewrite this like this. Using only these two properties, we can calculate all the Bernoulli numbers. For example, we get that the zeros Bernoulli number plus 2 times the first Bernoulli number must be 0. So the first Bernoulli number is minus 1/2. We also get that the second Bernoulli number is 1 over 6 and the third is 0. Let's now go back to this equation. We can plug in the Taylor series at 0 of the right side. Now we just have to compare the coefficients on both sides and get this expression for the zeta function at even integers. So we have found the value of this infinite sum. Using the same approach, we can also evaluate similar infinite sums. These are of the form of a Dirichlet series. For example, we can alternate the sign and get this function. This is called the Dirichlet Eta function. It's closely related to the Riemann Zeta function, as you can start by summing only terms with a positive sign and then subtract twice all the even terms. You can now factor out the 2 in the denominators and get this expression involving the Riemann Zeta function. This tells us that the Dirichlet Eta function is just a simple multiple of the Riemann Zeta function. In particular, this allows us to evaluate these two infinite sums. Here we also could have found the values by analyzing the generating function. Like before, there is a trigonometric function involved. It turns out 1 over cosine is also a generating function of some special infinite sum. Here we have the Dirichlet Beta function. This function is defined to be an alternating sum over the odd integers. To find the Taylor series at 0 of the right side in this equation, we are going to introduce the Euler numbers. Just as with the Bernoulli numbers, we get that the first Euler number is 1, and they satisfy this equation. From this we can calculate the first few Euler numbers. We can now once again compare coefficients in the generating function and the Taylor series on the right side and get this expression for the beta function at odd integers. For example, for n equal to 0, this tells us that this series evaluates to pi over 4. Finally, let's look again at the Riemann Zeta function. It satisfies this functional equation. Given the values at positive even integers, we can deduce from this the values at every negative integer. These are just minus the n plus 1 Bernoulli number divided by n plus 1. So we know the value of the zeta function at the positive even integers and at all the negative integers. So what's the value at the odd positive integers? Not very much is known about these. For instance, the value at 3 is called Apiary's constant, and it's proven to be irrational. For the Dirichlet beta function, we also have a functional equation, and given our known values, we can again deduce the values at the negative integers.